all that important Provincetown coverage.
On all the folks at sea.
So, off the 90 slides tonight, so I'm gonna turn it right over to him. He's gonna talk to you about what dessert they have called the Raspberry Pi.
Yeah, they didn't have it on the menu for dinner, unfortunately.
Okay, good evening. Once again, I'm Bob Evans. And when I was asked to give this talk about Raspberry Pi and Arduino, it rolled off people's tongues just like they're the same thing. And to me, having worked with both of them, they're very different. You know, here's a Raspberry Pi. You see this little board here. And this little board here is an Arduino Uno. Gee, they look like they're about the same thing, the same size, maybe they're the same power. So hopefully by the end of this, you will understand what the difference is between them, have an idea about some of the ways to use them, and I'll give you some examples of that, and lots of places to look for more information. My talk is loaded with URLs. This is, to me, it looks orange on my screen, a little red here. This particular URL was on that piece of paper that everybody put their name on. Get them back, or get one back at the end of the meeting so you don't have to write this down. A copy of my slides is there. There's a whole another pile of them here on the table. And other information. So I'm going to give you lots of references that you won't be able to write it all down, but I think if this stuff is interesting to you, it'll be a way you can start to find the information you need for what you might want to do with these. So what I'm going to talk about is to understand the difference between them and how to use them, I have to talk about, give a background of computer, I better put the mouse down, of computer architecture basics. Then I'm going to talk about how we got to where we are today, a single board computer, which is a pretty exciting thing. Although they've been around since maybe the 1970s, there was this thing called the Naked Alpha LSI in the 1970s, which was a single board computer. It was this big thing, it drew a lot of power, it wasn't as powerful as a PC. These are very impressive devices. And with that background, then we can compare them, a couple more definitions, we'll talk about Arduino, we'll talk about Raspberry Pi, I've got a little demo for you and so on. So let's jump right into that. The first definition, a stored program digital computer, which these are. So two things, digital computer as opposed to an analog computer. You go back 50 years, there were computers that computed with varying voltages at, you know, an analog value as opposed to discrete particular values in a digital computer. Generally the values which we represent by 0 and 1 might be a high voltage and a low voltage inside. And then stored programs. The program, the instructions for the computer are stored in an electronic memory. The earliest computers that we were making during World War II, the program was not in electronic memory. At Harvard University under Howard Aikin, they built the Harvard Mark I. IBM was instrumental in that project. You can go to the Harvard Science Center today and see a big chunk of it on display there in the lobby of the Harvard Science Center. It's just off Harvard Square. The memory of that computer was a punched paper tape, so it couldn't be varied. You had to set up the program, the set of instructions, and it would follow that and then do a computation. So based on that, we have what's called a Harvard architecture. Separate memories where the data is and where the instructions or the program are. The data memory, as the computation happens, you read the data, you do a calculation and you store new data. So that memory has to be writable. The instruction memory could be writable or could be not writable. We'll see some examples of that. A picture of the Harvard architecture. What we see here is this box is what's called the central processing unit or CPU. It's got two pieces. Most important is the control unit, which controls the whole computer. It picks a particular part of instruction memory, reads an instruction from it. It sends that instruction to the arithmetic and logic unit. That's where the processing actually happens. And the processing, or what that might be, is it might be, you know, take a number from data memory and just put it into the ALU. Take a different number from data memory and add it to the number that's already there. Take the number that's there and store it at a different location in the data memory. And then to communicate with the outside world, there are input and output devices, or I/O, which on different computers, the different things are input and output devices. The punch card reader might be, you know, from the past, or a tape drive. What we had today, network card, a screen, a USB connector, those are the input-output devices. In contrast to that, there's another computer architecture called the von Neumann architecture. And this is based on the machines that were built like ENIAC at the, I forget the name of the university in Pennsylvania, the Moore School of in Pennsylvania, and that's a vacuum tube computer. And the key thing about this is the von Neumann architecture, you have one memory, both the instructions and the data in this same memory. And so it has to be read-write memory to store the data and the instructions. And then a picture of that. So here we can see there's the one memory, and the data comes in and then gets stored in this memory during the computation. It's used and, you know, goes through various arithmetic changes in the computation. And then when we have output for an output device, it's sent to the output device. So this picture separates the input and the output, whereas the other one, they were together. And the input and output could be visualized either way. That's not the important distinction. The important distinction is there's just this one memory with the both the instructions and the data. So now let's go a little trip down memory lane. Look at some old computers coming up to the present. And the reason I want to talk about that is I'm going to talk about what I call speeds and feeds, how I characterize these computers. How fast they go, that's the speeds, and the feed is how much data it can handle. And these are key differences when I look at Arduino and Raspberry Pi. And also, it's kind of interesting to see, to understand just how powerful or not powerful these are. In 1951, the Whirlwind came into service. Vacuum tube logic, von Neumann design, so one memory, the speed of the CPU, and I'm going to talk a lot about instructions per second, or actually the unit I'm going to use is millions of instructions per second, or MIPS, M-I-P-S. This particular CPU is capable of executing an instruction in 50 microseconds, and so that equates to 20,000 instructions a second. But if you look at the whole cycle, it had to first fetch an instruction from the memory, then perform the instruction, or maybe fetch data as part of executing that instruction. And the memory, sometimes it's called the von Neumann bottleneck, that you have to hit the memory twice for each instruction you execute, once for the instruction to fetch it in order to have the information telling the computer what to do, and wants to fetch data from memory or to write a result to memory in order to actually do that operation. So you have two memory cycles for each instruction. When this was originally built, it was with 2,000 words of memory. These are 16-bit words. The unit I'm using is bytes and actually megabytes when I talk about memory size. So this is small compared to that. The original memory was Williams tubes, which stored bits by charge on the front of a CRT, and you could write charge there and you could read it back and see if there was a lot of charge or little charge based on what a plate inside the tube would detect. They were slow. They tended to have errors because if the electron beam got deflected to the wrong point by like a trolley car going down the street, giving you a little bit of change in the magnetic field, then you might read the wrong bit. They had to put them in Faraday cages, so there's an electric shield completely around it. But that didn't give you magnetic shielding against slow-moving magnetic fields like that trolley car. During the course of this project, new memory technology came out, the magnetic core memory, which was the main computer memory when I first got involved in computers. This computer came into service before I was born. This particular computer was the fastest computer of the early 1950s. It was It was in service to 1959. To use the Whirlwind, you had to walk inside it. It was in the Barter building in Cambridge on three different floors. The power supplies were in the basement, and the CPU and the memory was on the main floor, the ground floor, and the upstairs was where they controlled it. And here's a picture of the console room with Jay Forrester. He was the project leader on Whirlwind. He holds the patent for core memory, and he was being interviewed in this particular scene. There's a much more commonly seen picture, if you Google Whirlwind computer, this same room, and this little gadget here that's on the floor is usually on this table here, and there's like three people around it. That's generally what you see for Whirlwind. Ken Olson, who became the founder of Digital Equipment, was involved in the Whirlwind project as well, and I think, you know, he learned a lot of things there he was later able to apply. So, vacuum tube logic, 20,000 instructions a second, 2,000 words of memory, 16 bits per word, 4K bytes of memory. Let's jump to the 1960s. In 1964, the control data 6600 came into service, the first supercomputer. No longer using vacuum tubes for the CPU, discrete silicon transistors, 2N706s, 708s, things like that, transistors that I've seen they can oscillate at UHF. Again, a von Neumann design, 10 megahertz clock, but there were four phases of the clock, so it was almost like having a 40 megahertz clock. This machine could execute 3 million floating point operations per second, and it was not really a RISC computer in terms of reduced instruction set, but it used a bunch of characteristics that RISC computers later used. This computer had 10 functional units in the CPU, so it could be doing a floating point add at the same time it was doing an integer multiply. The words were 60 bits long.
Was it pipeline like a RISC machine, or was it really more like a VLIW machine?
No, this was pipeline like a RISC machine in that it would dispatch an instruction. What it did is they had this thing they called the scoreboard, which kept track of all the registers. There were 24 registers inside, and every time it got ready to dispatch an instruction, it would see if the inputs to that, all those registers were free. It wasn't worried about the output, because if you said, you know, to perform an earlier instruction, that was going to put a value into the same register you were going to write into, it didn't matter. The CPU, in fact, an interesting thing about this computer is the CPU could only communicate with memory and the registers. It couldn't communicate with I.O. at all. There were separate processors, what were called the peripheral processors, that did the I.O. So the CPU didn't do anything but this blinding fast calculation. Seymour Cray led this project, and they didn't care how much it cost. They really, like, if they sold enough of them to be profitable, the only goal was be fast. And, you know, everything you could do in the 1960s to make a fast computer. For scientific computation, weather forecasting by simulation, the fastest computer from when it was introduced in 1964 to 1969, when the next Seymour Cray machine got announced that ran faster than it. There was a big to-do at IBM because of this. So the amount of memory, let me jump back to the important thing, okay? The amount of memory, about a megabyte of memory. You remember what a megabyte is? This is a megabyte of memory. One of these. Well, no, it could be a 720K floppy too in that size. And the amount of memory on a total of 1 megabyte, and then the instruction speed itself, I'm saying it's 3 million. And the fact that they're floating point instructions, which tend to be a very complex instruction, a lot of bit manipulation, is just incredibly impressive. So let's look at one. Here's a picture from control data. While I was in college, I was a computer operator on a 6600. That's why I'm so excited about it. This was a sexy machine, let me tell you. This is the CPU and memory and peripheral processors are in this cabinet. And it was made with chiller units at the very outside ends of the cross. And all the wires were as short as possible. So they got four chassis. They made it together this way. They were paying attention to the fact that to go 1 foot through a piece of wire, you would, you know, you had a delay. And it was significant. You have a card punch, you have two card readers. They handled cards with air, not with mechanical things moving the cards. They read 20 cards a second or 1,200 cards a minute. There's tape drives here. And they used a very wide tape, the same tape that was the original videotape in the studios. Line printer, I don't know what this is. This looks like another line printer, actually. This is an interactive terminal. Okay. This is an interactive terminal for time sharing. This is disk storage, removable disks. And this is the operator console. The operator console had one keyboard and two screens, 1964. I mean, this is what we do on our computers today, you know, on our desktop. It was just really advanced, and the shape of everything was like furniture from Star Trek.
And the tape drives read at 3,600 feet per minute.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I only know because I went to Control Data Institute.
So let's, a year later, at the other end of the spectrum, that came out with a computer called the PDP-8. Totally different purpose, okay? Low cost, small. There was a lot of use for these in laboratories, machine control, and so on. Diode transistor logic, still a von Neumann design, but much, much slower. You know, we were less than two-thirds of a megahertz of the CPU speed. It took about two clock cycles to run an instruction. Tabletop sized. And here's a picture of the PDP-8. This is the original 8.
Oh, no,
this is a classic 8. And when I talk about the memory, the original 8 only had 4K of 12-bit words of memory, which I'm using as my data point for 65. You're talking about later computers that were, you know, either faster or bigger, but still PDP-8s.
Thank you, Bob.
You want to remind
you? No, it is not. Well, it turns out that I didn't use 8s, but I used PDP-11s a lot, and you had to toggle in the 16 front, on the switches in the front panel, you had to toggle in the 16-word bootstrap loader, maybe it was a 10-word bootstrap loader, but you would put the address and load address, and that would set it to that address, then you'd put the first word of data and say store, and it would store, and it would increment the address, you put the next word of data in the switches, and you got to the point where your fingers knew how to flip the switches without you looking at it, because you did this so often, and then you would say load address and start, and to pick the instruction where it would start executing the system, and that was enough to get it to read from a paper tape or from a disk drive to read the program into memory, and then you might have to, again, halt it when it was done reading your program and set another start address, and then it would finally start running your program. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was so tangible, you know? Switches and lights. I really miss them.
Well, it had core memory, so you could turn it off, halt it, turn it off, ship it around the world, and turn it back on.
Well, that's an important point. Core memory was non-volatile. The information you stored in it, even if after the power was gone, it was retained in the core. So you could turn the machine off, come in the next day, and usually we left, you know, the top 16 words of memory for this bootstrap loader, so you didn't always have to toggle it in. And even in the 1970s, the PDP-11 I used at that time had core memory. Meanwhile, at MIT, they developed for NASA the Apollo Guidance Computer. This is one of the first computers to use integrated circuits for the logic devices. Resistor, transistor, logic. Harvard architecture, the last couple of machines were von Neumann architecture. The clock was a 1 megahertz clock, but based on the design of this processor, it ran really slowly in that, you know, it was taking about 20 clock cycles to run an instruction just for an addition. The memory, now we've got two memories here, okay? With a total of 76 kilobytes. The data memory, 2 kilowords of RAM, 16-bit words, and the instruction memory, or for the program, read-only memory, ROM, 36,000 words. Purpose was, this computer was embedded, there were two. If you remember, on the Apollo project, there was the command module and the lunar excursion module. Each one of them had one of these computers in it. And control of the spacecraft and navigation was basically it. And, you know, the design goals were small form factor, couldn't weigh much, had to use a small amount of power based on the constraints in the spacecraft. And this is what it looked like. You can see the system box, which is about a cubic foot, and you can see the disky display and keyboard that was the operator console where they used this, you know, the astronauts interacted with it from that. And they had a whole plan to fly to the moon and back. They had to, like, hit 10,000 different keys on this to direct the computer to do the next step and the next step. So the man was actually part of the system because all the stuff wasn't stored in the computer that was necessary to fly the mission. 1970, semiconductor memory was purchasable at probably $500 a chip, 1,000 bits in a chip. The Intel, and Intel was a memory company back then. They weren't the general purpose silicon processor company. The 1103, an eighth of a kilobyte, each bit individually addressable, dynamic RAM, DRAM. It was faster and cheaper than Core, and almost instantly in all the new designs, they started using semiconductor memory instead of Core memory. And Core memory disappeared, you know, by the 72 to 75 time frame. And the finances drove that. The computer systems of those days, Gordon Bell used to say that it was 20% the cost of the computer was the cost of memory. And so if you look at the price of the computers, you know, the 6600 was a $10 million machine. So that was $2 million just for the memory. So this of course, was something to drive us. And then the next year, the first single chip processor came out, the Intel 4004. It was intended to be used in a calculator. That's what drove the project. Technology is what's called silicon gate technology, and I don't really know what the circuit is for that, or what different words for that. Every reference I found called it that. It's a Harvard architecture, right? So again, separate instructions and data in the memory. This ran 0.07 of a MIP, and the memory was a total of 4.6 kilobytes. Most of it was actually the program, this ROM, and then a small amount, these four bits words of memory, could each hold a digit in binary coded decimal. And remember, it's a calculator, so it was all working in decimal digits. This same processor ended up being embedded in Pioneer 10, and before Voyager, Pioneer 10 was the man-made object that flew furthest into space that we maintained communications with. Now, at some point, we think the nuclear power source on it failed to provide enough power, and we couldn't hear it anymore. So that really was kind of an impressive ride for such an early processor. And it is what we call the first microprocessor. So a microprocessor is a CPU in one chip. Here's what the 4004 looked like. So you've got a 16-pin DIP chip here, dual inline pins chip, a photo of it in the pinout. A couple of years later, the 8008 was out, and a hobbyist, John Titus, who was a member of the MMRA 15 years ago, I think in January, he gave us a talk on the Mark 8. He had his Mark 8 at the meeting and talked about the experience of it. It's a von Neumann design, clock speed, 0.02 of a MIP. And the memory, you could put 0.25 kilobyte or 256 bytes of memory into it, or you could build it up to more. The architectural limit of that processor was 16 kilobytes. I doubt anybody ever built a Mark 8 with that much memory. If you look at the pictures of it, the circuit boards are really crude with the separate chips really far apart and hand-drawn traces on the board. And this was not really meant for anything but other than entertainment, of toggle in a program on the front panel and make it run. Nonetheless, particularly someone like me, I was a computer science major at the time, when the magazine article came out and you had the cover with the Mark 8 on it, that was really exciting. And it suggests it could do a lot by having this paper tape here. But if there was no paper tape reader. So that's when the personal computers really started. There were 6502 based computers, the VIC, the PET, the Apple II in the late 70s. And by 81, we had the IBM PC come out. So I'm jumping to that because I have some numbers for the IBM PC.
You missed all the 8080 based, you know, the SOM20, the S100 computers.
That's right.
The M-Sign.
Z80s. I have an Alpha 8800. TRS-80 is sort of, yeah, that actually was a Z80.
So the 8088 processor had 16-bit words but an 8-bit bus, and when you read a value into it, it had to do two bus cycles just to transfer this one word, and this slowed it down quite a lot, almost a 5 megahertz clock, and, you know, two-tenths of a MIP. The memory, IBM PC, it came with 64 kilobytes of memory. The maximum you could put in was 256 kilobytes of memory. But it ran business applications, VisiCalc, and things like that. And, you know, it was like a computer after the Apple II with VisiCalc. This was the one that it made it something that would be bought for businesses, and that volume made them cheap enough that, you know, you could then buy them, you know, for home also. And this is what it looked like. The storage was two floppy disk drives. Later on, you could get a hard disk for it. The first ones were, I think, 5 megabytes or 10 megabytes, and the wonderful, very rugged, heavy keyboard. Maybe, I don't know. Yeah.
That one was a monochrome one, you can tell by the mouse.
So I'm jumping forward to the end of the 1990s, and everybody was cloning the IBM design. I call this a white box computer. You know, it might be a Pentium 2 or Pentium 3, about 500 megahertz. They were claiming, and now they were using RISC techniques inside the Pentium processor, that they were getting almost one instruction per clock cycle. So they claim close to 600 MIPS on some web page I found for a 450 megahertz processor. The memory might range up to half a gigabyte of memory. And this could be a server, like serving web pages in the 1990s, or it could be a desktop PC, that same thing. They weren't as distinct as they are now. Jump forward to the computer you might have bought 2 years ago. Intel Haswell, microprocessor, von Neumann design, CPU speed, 3 gigahertz, multiple cores, maybe 8 cores with hyperthreading, meaning 2 different instruction streams per core, and these 8 cores in the processor, so a total of 16 different threads of execution all going on concurrently inside the CPU. Creative workstation, you know, editing videos, things like that. Virtualization host, where you run virtual machines inside. I'm not talking a server machine, I'm talking a desktop personal computer. And this is the kind of stuff, you know, you can buy today. It's the numbers are just incredible. So let's go look at the numbers, kind of summarize our trip down computer memory lane here. Okay, starting with Whirlwind, and I've got 2 things I'm showing you here. I'm showing you the heavy blue bars are the speed in millions of instructions per second. And the red line is showing you the maximum memory capacity for each of those computers. So the first two I talked about, the Whirlwind and the 6600, these were sort of like one-of-a-kind, price-is-no-object computers, and they're kind of off the curve. But all these other computers are ones that a single person would use at a time. The Apollo guidance computers, you know, just one astronaut interacting with it at a time. And so they're all sort of personal computers. And I'm going to talk about Arduino and Raspberry Pi on this graph once I've introduced them. So let's try to get into those next. A couple of more definitions. Microprocessor. Microprocessor is the whole CPU, that's the arithmetic logic unit and the control in one chip. Usually, the microprocessors are when we use that word for them, they're fast. They could use a lot of power. In server computers, the microprocessors draw over 100 watts, which means that's 100 watts of heat, as much heat as a 100-watt light bulb that has to be dissipated, or it's going to, you know, it's going to just burn up for each of those processors. So that's why they have these big heat sinks and fans and so on. Usually the computers that use these, the processor is not so much programmable as the memory that's connected to it can be changed by the computer itself. So you don't need another computer to support it. Field programmable can be changed in the field or changed as you use it. You can use the computer to change its own programming. They come in families, and examples of the families that are common today are the Intel Core, the ARM, which is used in cell phones, set-top boxes, and things like that. The DEC Alpha, which is not so popular today. PA RISC and PowerPC. Those are different families of processors, microprocessors. Single board computer, a whole computer on one little circuit board. So if you've got microprocessor, you've got memory, you've got input-output devices, you have a power supply of some sort or a regulator. Examples of those are the BeagleBone made by TI, something called the Hackberry, which I don't know much about, the Intel Edison, little Intel architecture board, the Raspberry Pi, and the Snickerdoodle, which is an exciting board because you get a whole bunch of FPGA on the same board and RF, 2 gigahertz RF, all on that board. A couple of references for that. If you follow my original link, I've got pointers to where you can get some more information about the Snickerdoodle. And a microcontroller. So a microcontroller is intended not like a general purpose computer, but more like to control a device. It's a whole computer in a chip. And they usually run slower, using less power, intended to be embedded in a device to make the device smart. Your bathroom scale, a smart thermostat, your washing machine or dishwasher, it has to control the different cycles it goes through, cameras, clocks, smartwatch, bicycle computer, MP3 players, a radio with a display that's an alphanumeric display. They all have microcontrollers in them. And a lot of them, they can go so low power that you can put batteries in them and 10 years later, you know, there's no turn-off switch, but they know until you push a button to activate them, make them do anything, not to draw power from the batteries. So I got an example I'll show you, and I put, about 10 years ago, I put the two AAA batteries in this device that's got a microcontroller in it, and, you know, those batteries are still usable. The pins of the chip are the I.O. devices. And when I talk about Arduino, I'll explain that a little more. So the Atmel AVR is an example of a microcontroller family, the microchip PIC parallax propeller. Here's the coffee machine where I work in the employee lounge. This has a microcontroller inside. You know, you've got this display that tells you ready to brew, when to remove your drink, exactly, you know, step by step. It's got these different buttons that are input. And in addition to the display as an output, it's got actuators inside. It's got solenoids that open the door where you put the coffee pot in. It's got solenoids that control the flow of water, when to start and when to stop. And finally, it blows some air to push the last little bits of water out into your cup. So just by looking at that device, it's like, that's so smart. I know it's got a microcontroller in it. And this is the kind of thing an Arduino could easily do. Another example of a microcontroller, the Island Keyer, which happens to use a PIC microcontroller. The PIC is the big chip over here, 16F876, and it's a very common PIC. Now, that particular chip, okay, it's got a fair amount of memory, 14 kilobytes of flash memory for its instructions, but very little memory for data. It's got, you know, 368 bytes of RAM. When it's powered down, that RAM's not going to hold its contents, and it's got electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. So that's memory that it can write under control of the program, and it's non-volatile. When the power goes away, it'll retain its contents, just like the ROM does, but it's changeable. And to extend that memory, because this device is a keyer that stores, among other things, you can have a bunch of stored messages in it. So they have this other chip here, which we also, we use these inside the servers that we build. We call it a CPROM, a serial electrically erasable programmable read-only memory, and that holds things on our servers. It holds things like the serial number of the machine and the BIOS settings and things like that. So that particular keyer is this device right here. I built one, and you can see the same boards here, and it's got those two batteries I put in years ago, and you could hook it up to paddles and your rig, and it's a speed control here and stored memories, which you can barely hear because this is very low. But I'll pass it around. You can push a button. You can hear. Huh? That's from a TK50, yes. So that's an example of a microcontroller in action. One more definition, the development board. A development board is a board that contains logic, microprocessor, or microcontroller. When you're developing a product, you want to be able to connect to it, have software for testing, be able to easily load programs into it, be able to debug it. So a development board has that extra access to it. Once you have a product, a design for a product, you don't want a development board. You don't want all that extra stuff. You just want the chip to put inside the product. But once to figure out how to use the chip, you need a development board. Now, why am I even telling you about that? Well, let's go look at the Arduino. The Arduino is a family of development boards based on the Atmel AVR and similar microcontrollers. I'm going to talk about the Arduino Uno. It's the only one I've worked with. The particular processor is the ATmega 38328P microcontroller, Harvard architecture, clock speed 16 megahertz, and it executes about an instruction per clock cycle. So the instruction speed is about 16 million instructions per second. The total memory is 35 kilobytes. So this CPU is a lot faster than the Apollo guidance computer, but the amount of memory is pretty much just about the same. Harvard architecture again, so I have separate flash memory that's holding the instructions, and I've got a data memory, two types. I've got volatile static RAM that needs electricity applied to the chip to hold its data, and electrically erasable ROM where you can store information that'll under program control that'll stay there even without power. Here's a close-up of an Arduino connected to a breadboard, and it's controlling this display here. It looks a lot like that display on the coffee machine. So what's the I.O. devices? As I said, on a microcontroller, it's the pins. The Arduino pins, the I.O. devices, each pin has one of three states. Either it's an input or an output, and by default they are an input, which means they're high impedance. They're not going to draw significant current from the circuit they're connected to, which is the default that you need. You can optionally say to have the chip apply 20K ohm pull-up to pull that up to the supply voltage. The Arduino runs on 5 volts, so the high voltage is 5 volts, so it's 20K to 5 volts, and it could be an output pin where it would be pulled either down to 0 volts or up to 5 volts. Important point about this, the absolute max current limit per pin is 40 milliamps, and the total for the whole chip on either supply or on ground is 200 milliamps. And that's microprocessor or microcontroller absolute max ratings. Recommended is 20 mils per chip. And you'll see how I applied it in the example that's coming up. Arduino output, the program that controls the Arduino, and you have to write the program or you have to get one for the application that you're using, calls a instruction, digital write, a subroutine call, and if you write a 0 or a 1, it's going to cause the pin to be pulled to either 0 volts or 5 volts. And there's also analog output. If the pin is an analog output, by calling analog write, you set the width of the pulse of the pin's going to go back and forth at a 500 hertz rate. The amount of time it's high versus the amount of time it's low. Let's see what that looks like. It's called pulse width modulation, PWM. And the percent, the number you write goes from 0 to 255, expressing the percent of time that the signal is going to be at the high level. So when you write a 0, it's always at the low level. When you write 64, which is a quarter of that range, 25% of the time it's at a high level, the rest of the time at low level. 128, 50, and 50. 191, these are decimal numbers. Three quarters of the time it's at the high level. And finally, if you write a 255, it's always high. So if you had a motor connected to this, it could control the speed of the motor. Or an LED, it could control the brightness of the LED. Arduino input. It's to sense the voltage of the pin when you make the call to the library routine. And there's two different types of input. There's, and as I said earlier, you know, optionally you can have a pull-up. And why the pull-up? Let's suppose you want to sense a switch. You connect one side of the switch to ground and the other side to the pin, and you have the pull-up. If the switch is open, it'll get pulled up to plus 5. If the switch is closed, it'll pull it down to ground. You don't need any other circuitry. So that's a place where you would use the pull-up, where you have a contact closure that you want to measure. If your circuit, your external circuit, is capable of asserting a voltage that's going to be high or low all by itself, then you don't want the pull-up, because that's just going to cause a load on the external circuit. So you have to think about what you're connecting to decide, is the pull-up appropriate or not? So let's look at digital input now. Program calls, digital read, and the Arduino is going to sense, is the pin high or low? The region from 0.2 volts to 0.7 volts is called the noise region. In other words, if the signal is in that range, it's undefined what you're going to get. You'll either get a high or a low, but you can't be sure. To be low, it has to be between 0 and 0.2 volts. And anything above 0.7 will definitely read as a high. So the thing that's creating the signal, if you want a reliable read, has to give you a value that won't be inside the noise region. An analog read, when the program calls analog read, it senses the pin voltage, but now it's going to say, well, just what voltage is that? And it divides it into 1,024 different values. By default, that's between 0 and 5 volts. So you're dividing that, that's like a 5 millivolt difference. For every 5 millivolts, every 5 thousandths of a volt, you're going to get a different number. So you can pretty precisely read a value using the analog input. So let's look at an Arduino close-up. You've got a USB connector here, which is how you get the program into it, a reset button, a little chip here that is for the USB interface. This is another Atmel microprocessor. This is the DIP, the main processor of the microcontroller. This is capacitors and voltage regulator here, a 16 megahertz crystal. That's the clock for the system. These are the pins, and most of these connect right to pins on the processor chip itself. Outside of connected to USB, you can also get power from this external power connector. Yes? These are pretty, I like to use a static bag to protect it, but I have found I haven't had a problem with it. You know, most of my time when I'm working with these, it's in winter, because summer I'm doing other things, and I haven't zapped one. So looking more closely, and if you're going to do a circuit with an Arduino, you need a diagram like this. These are different classes of what the pins are. So this yellow, AVR, this means that one of the Arduino pins connects right to one of the pins on the AVR microcontroller. Digital are the ones that can be used for digital input and digital output. It's almost all of them, and what's left are the ones that are for power. And the reset is actually one of the signal pins here that goes right to one of the pins on the Arduino chip. Analog means that these are ones that can be used for analog input. Only a few of them can be used for that. And then we got PWM, yeah, here, the red PWM, pulse width modulation, different pins. These ones here are what can be used for pulse width modulation that are marked red. So depending upon how you want to use a pin, you have to pick a pin that, you know, is capable of doing that function. Almost all of them can do the digital input or digital output. There are a few pins which, by convention, are used for certain type of connection. Serial bus, this is like RS-232 type of connection, but it's not RS-232 signal levels. It's between 0 and 5 volts. And those pins are
right by your hand.
Right here, these two. And I squared C, these two pins up here, that's a two-wire bus plus ground. There's a clock wire and a data wire with a master that controls the bus and the slave devices that have separate addresses. Commonly used, in my experience, we see them in server computers where you've got a little computer that's controlling the server and can read temperatures, fan speeds, all from sensors that are on that bus, tell parts of the computer to turn on and off, things like that. And then there's another bus, this SPI, and that's the same kind of interconnect that an SD card uses, and that's a four-wire bus. Two of the pins are capable of interrupting the processor, waking it up when it's asleep, and that's the kind of thing that you might use to cause it to wake up and, you know, from a draw no power state to a draw power state. When they talk about Arduinos, they talk about shields, and they have this pattern of the pinout. All different kind of things could plug into those pins. This particular shield is one that's sold by Adafruit. It's got a color display on it, and it's got a little joystick here, and it's got an SD card. And with one of these and a program in an Arduino, you could make, for example, a digital picture frame where you have pictures on the card, and it displays them there. And, you know, based on the joystick, you can control it and pick different pictures. James brought in some shields here that are Arduino shields.
This is a
Pi. This is Pi's? Oh, sorry.
But in the little bag is the Arduino Mini Pro, which does everything that the big board does, except for it doesn't have the USB and the USB to serial chip on it. So if you built something on your Uno and you don't want to have that big $30 board, you have a $5 board that does everything.
And this is what you would use when you go into production, unless you have a custom circuit board. So this has a surface mount chip, the same processor, from this is the same AVR microprocessor, microcontroller.
Arduino Mini Pro. It's the exact same processor. Everything Bob said.
So I also have one called a Boarduino, which is kind of in between. It uses the DIP chip, but it's on a small board. But that's even smaller. That's the size of a postage stamp. And, you know, there's just one little surface mount chip on there. So how do you program an Arduino? The programs are called sketches. And this is a simplified dialect of C++. You use the integrated development environment, the IDE, which gives you, we already saw this, easy access to the GPIOs, digital read, digital write, analog read, analog write, those commands to access the pins. The IDE itself is written in Java. It can run on Linux, it can run on Windows, it can run on Mac OS, and my belief is it looks the same. I've only used it on Linux. It's what I've got running on this PC here. When you write your sketch, it must have two things you have to provide. It has to have a setup function. The setup function is going to be called when the board comes out of reset. When your program starts, setup will be called. And then after that, the loop routine, the other part you have to provide, gets repeatedly called. So let's look at using an Arduino to blink a LED. This is about the simplest thing you can use it for. And the circuit is, we're going to use pin 13, digital output. We're going to have a current limiting resistor. Current's going to flow through the lead when that's pulled high, and the other end goes to ground. But when I built it, it's like, well, I wanted this to be bright enough for everybody to see it. So I put two LEDs in mine. And that's what's on the table there. And if I didn't break it in transporting it here, we'll have our demo. The resistors I used, 330 ohms. These LEDs, when they're turned on, they drop about 2 volts, leaving me about 3 volts. So in other words, I'm going to draw about 9 milliamps for each of these LEDs, a total of 18, comfortably within the 20 mil, be very safe with your pins on the Arduino. And let's look at the program that you would use to blink the LEDs. Setup at the top, it says pin 13 is going to be an output. And then we'll call the loop. The loop says make pin 13 high by calling digital write. Wait for a second, delay for 1,000 milliseconds. Then call digital write, make pin 13 low, so it's down to 0 volts, and delay another second. As soon as that exits, we go back to the beginning, and we just do that over and over again. So let me do a demonstration for you. Here I've got my Arduino. I've got my Arduino, I've got my USB cable, I have a battery here. Although I could, you know, I could use a wall wart. I could use a wall wart and plug this into the power jack just as well. Plug that in, it powers up, nothing else is blinking, but I know that it's powered. I'm not going to type that program in and bore you with waiting for my bad typing.
Can you compile it on somewhere else and you know, download it to that?
That's what I'm going to do.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. Okay, can I switch to the Arduino development environment? This is the Arduino IDE. I need to be where I can see the screen to do this. And same exact program we just looked at. And I have another board that I also can load software into. So one of the things you want to do is you want to make sure it's set for the type of board you're using. You see Arduino Uno is selected. That's the type of board I have. I've already plugged the board in. So that's the right type of board. I'll click on that again. And here's my program, and then all I have to do is tell it to, this will compile and load it into the Arduino. Compiles my program, it pushes it in, here's some output from the compiler. This is important, what's at the bottom here. The compiler that's behind this is GCC, GNU Compiler Collection, that understands this, which is a pretty good compiler base. The size of this particular, my sketch was very simple, but I needed the Arduino runtime, at least the routines I called. I needed digital write, I needed the pin mode routine, and I needed the stuff that's gonna initialize the chip. So that's 1,000 bytes, but if I added a little more to this program, it wouldn't grow that much. However, this is important because you run out of memory when you get to 32,000. And about 0.5 bytes is the bootloader, which is what's used to interface to this to let it respond to my computer when I want to upload a program. So that program is now inside the board. And after it was loaded, it reset, and the lights are blinking. So my board's program that's in flash, it's going to remember it even without power. And if I plug into the battery, again, I've got my blinking LEDs here, like we saw before. Now, pin 13 is great because you probably couldn't see this before, but if I take this out, there's a tiny little LED on the board here, this yellow one by my finger, that's also blinking. that comes with an LED. You don't really need the external ones if you want to write this program and play with it. The Jim's Arduino doesn't come with the LED, but does it?
Yeah,
it has LED on pin 13 and a power LED.
Yep.
Okay.
And what you have to do is plug in an external little USB board to get your USB connection.
So
use a little $5 helper board.
So we're gonna give you one of these some lucky attendee very shortly. Okay, so now you've seen kind of how to program the Arduino, what it is, how easy it is to use, and I find this stuff a lot of fun. Last winter, I was working on an Arduino program to make a radio-controlled clock, you know, to receive the signal from WWVB. It's not the radio part, but once you get the signal from this, which comes at about a pulse a second, to be able to convert that and to automatically set a clock based on that. Okay, so I want to go back to that one, yeah. Okay, let's talk about Raspberry Pi. Development board, remember, helps you develop your application to run on that small microprocessor. But now the chip is a Broadcom BCM 283, and there's a couple of different models depending on which Raspberry Pi you're on. They call them a system on a chip. Sounds a lot like what the AVR microcontroller is. With an ARM processor, also a GPU, a graphical coprocessor, it runs at 0.7 to 1 gigahertz, 1 to 4 cores. The memory is from a quarter of a gigabyte up to a whole gigabyte of memory. The I.O. there's GPIO pins, but there's also USB, HDMI for audio and video, LAN, wired network, audio output. It runs an operating system. The Raspberry Pi Foundation's supported operating system is Raspbian, which is Linux. There's other flavors of Linux like Ubuntu. Windows will run on the latest Raspberry Pi board, Windows 10. And there's another operating system I don't have experience with called RISC OS. And these links will give you information. Was there a question?
Yeah, it also has SPI and I2C.
Yes, but that's from the GPIO pins, the SPI and the I2C, just like the in the Arduino. The block diagram of the Raspberry Pi looks like this. So you've got your CPU and GPU in the center, that's the heart of the system. It's talking to memory. There is a USB hub that has a wired Ethernet port and two USB jacks. This is the Raspberry Pi Model B. And it's got all those types of I.O. that I talked about previously. So here's a Raspberry Pi Model B. I'll pass this around. We're done with the code. Okay, just get it back here to me at the end, and I'm great. And if you wanted wireless network instead, you can see there's an Ethernet connector on it. You go buy one of these. This is a little Wi-Fi dongle, USB, and you plug it in there. And, you know, this was, I don't know, $5 or $10 at Micro Center. I think this was $8 at Micro Center. I plugged it into my Raspberry Pi, it just worked. They won't all just work, but the ones that work with Linux do. So this is what the board looks like that I'm passing around. We've got the GPIO pins are here. We've got composite video, audio, two USB stacked. This is the wired Ethernet connector to RJ45, HDMI connector. The power connector is a micro USB. And then there's these two other connectors. This is for the Raspberry Pi camera. It's a special bus. And this is for a Raspberry Pi display. So I don't know if the displays are out. I think they are. But I have a Raspberry Pi camera on one of my Raspberry Pis, and I'm running a webcam from it.
You missed the important connector on the back next to the power connector.
On the back side, and you can see it on that, is where you plug in the SD card. This one takes a regular SD card, The newer ones take a micro SD card. I think the ones in this box here, they take a micro SD card. The Raspberry Pi has to boot from the SD card. The firmware that's built into the chip goes and looks at that, and then it brings the first program into memory that brings up the rest of the system.
The bootloader that you toggled in on the front of the...
No, I think it's... I think it's U-boot in this case. That's a lot to toggle in. Pin out. And this will get to the point that was just brought up. So we've got these various pins. We've got the power pins. One difference from the Arduino, this is 3.3 volt power, so logic high is 3.3 volts. It's not 5 volts. And if you have a peripheral for one device, it won't necessarily work with the other. So we've got our GPIO pins, two of which are for I2C. We've got the serial port here again, just like we have on the Arduino, and we have the SPI over here. And then more pins were added in the Model B Plus. If you get a Pi Zero, these pins exist, but they don't put a header in it. So you have to solder onto the board to connect to them or solder a header onto it. Here's a Raspberry Pi with a cobbler. The cobbler is a cable that goes on to that header with the GPIO pins, and it brings them down with pins that plug into a solderless breadboard. Really handy for breadboarding is what I'm used here. You just poke the parts in. It really saves you a lot of time. If you're doing it differently and you don't have a solderless breadboard, it's worth spending a few bucks and getting yourself one. And a handy thing about this cobbler is all the pins are labeled at the far end where they're going to come down on your breadboard, so it's easy to know, you know, which pin is which. Just like there are shields on the Arduino, which are these daughter boards that plug into the top with various I/O devices, there's what are called hats, or hardware attached on top. Same idea, but it's the name that they use in the Raspberry Pi family for a daughter board. Here's another example of an Adafruit one where you've got a display. This happens to be a touch screen, though, and this is showing the Raspbian desktop. So that's actually a Linux desktop really squeezed down onto a very small display. And we've got a bunch of hats here that, these are hats, right?
I guess you would call them hats.
this is the Raspberry Pi. This is the LED hat, which has got eight LEDs. That to display the state of various pins. This is a homemade design. What's the function?
It's an environmental monitor. It has RS-485, I2C, and some special one-wire I/O that goes to temperature and humidity sensors and ADCs.
Very nice. I'll talk more about one-wire. And lastly, a commercial relay board. So you've got contact closures here. You can control even line voltage, you know, go into a light bulb, that kind of thing, with a relay, which you definitely don't want to do with your pins on your little piece of silicon. So how do you program a Raspberry Pi? I'm not going to give you a whole example, but this is like a desktop PC. You got a processor that's, you know, it's as powerful as what's in my brand new cell phone. And as a result, you have a graphical screen. You can hook up a keyboard. It connects to a network. There's either a graphical user interface, or if you choose to, I connect to my Raspberry Pi over the network. I don't run the graphical user interface on it. I do everything from my own computer. The Raspbian operating system has available for you to download a lot of other software packages, which include all kinds of programming languages. C, Python, Perl, Shell Script, Fortran, you name it, you can probably get it. You can run Lisp, you can run web servers on them. I have Raspberry Pis as like file servers at home, things like that. If you're going to use the GPIOs, you need to load a device driver. The drivers come with Raspbian, but by default, they're not loaded. That memory is saved for something else. Well, let me take you through an example of a Raspberry Pi that I'm running. I want to read temperature. Now, unlike the Arduino, where we had analog input, the Raspberry Pi only has digital input. So to read temperature, I'm going to use a device that's going to read the temperature and send it to me as a digital signal. The particular one I'm using is the DS18B20 from Dallas Semiconductor. It's a digital temperature sensor, and it uses what's called a Dallas one-wire protocol. Each sensor connected has a unique address. Multiple ones can be connected to the same GPIO pin. In order to load the driver that knows how to talk to these sensors, you have to add an instruction, add a line of text to the file, /boot/config.txt. That file is read at the very beginning when you start up your Raspberry Pi, and it tells it different settings. For example, if you want to control whether or not you run the screen or how many pixels are going to be on the screen coming out the HDMI. And in this case, it says DT overlay. DT is device tree, and this is what the drivers are called. And the name of the driver we're going to load is called W1-GPIO. That's the one-wire GPIO driver. And just like Arduino, the pin can have a pull-up. We're saying don't use the pull-up. There's lots of information about this. If you have a Raspberry Pi and you've loaded Raspbian, in this file, /boot/overlays/readme, that explains about the different settings you can put into the config.txt for the purpose of adding drivers. There's other information on the Raspberry Pi website to talk about other things that can go in config.txt. So now let's look at the circuit for sensing temperature. So I got my Raspberry Pi on the left. I have the GPIO pin 4 by default. That's what this particular driver uses. So this is the signal. I have an external pull-up resistor. 4.7K is what I think I have. I have one of these, and I only have one temperature sensor, but because each sensor has a unique address, you can put 1,000 of them all on the same bus. They don't have to take their power from the Raspberry Pi. You need a pull-up on the signal line here, but each sensor could have its own power. The ground has to be in common, and the signal line is in common, so you don't have to run three wires out. You can run two wires out. This kind of thing is used a lot in factory automation, where they got all kinds of sensors spread through a factory. You don't have to use GPIO 4. You can pick a different pin, but I'm using the default one. So now you've got your sensors hooked up, and you have to discover them. When the operating system boots up, it loads the driver. The driver starts talking to this GPIO. There is a way it can figure out what are all the sensors that are connected, and it can find something like 10 or 15 a second. So if you have 1,000, you know, it's going to take it maybe 30 seconds or so to find all these sensors. And for each one, it makes, there's this directory, /sys/bus/W1, the one-wire bus, devices, and it makes a separate subdirectory for each device it discovers. At runtime, these appear. This file system exists just in memory. It's not anything on the SD card, or if you had a disk connected to the computer. It's not on the disk, but none the same. You can access it just like it's a directory on the disk. So conceptually, it's the same. So if you look to see which directories were created, you can find out which devices are there. And an example here, I've given you the command. This says to list the files that are in sysbusw1 devices, anything W1 slave. I have one temperature sensor on my Raspberry Pi, and what came back was the one device for my one temperature sensor. There's two pieces of information here, okay? Device type 28, which is this particular temperature sensor, because there's other one-wire devices that could be on this bus, and its unique serial number, this 64-bit serial number. And this W1 slave is the value where you can read the information from that device. So now that I know what my device, yes?
Quick question. Say I have 10 of those Dallas temperature sensors in 10 different rooms. Are they imprinted on the on the little device, does it have the serial number on it, or do you have to kind of read each one and keep track and say
That's a great question. So I only have one of these temperature sensors, and it didn't tell me what its address was. The only way I knew what the address was would be by plugging it into my computer, seeing what the address is. That won't change, and then I could, you know, it could be powered off, plugged into a different Raspberry Pi or a different computer. So yes, if you have multiple ones, you have to do that. I only happen to have one temperature sensor on my bus. So the only one I've got is the only one I read. And in fact, my command for reading the temperature sensor, I use a wild card, so I don't care what the serial number is. As long as there's one and only one, it's going to work properly. No, just the easy way out. Not cheating. So if you read the W1 slave file, that's going to give you the information to read the sensor. When your program reads from the sys file system of that file, it talks to the device and it gets the temperature. And what comes back, so here, the cat command says to read from this file, and it's going to type it out to my terminal. And so I read from this file here. See, I used the wild card. And what you get back is these two lines of text. The first line, the important thing is the yes. The yes says, I have a valid reading, I have a good reading. And I believe it works, I'm guessing, by taking a CRC of the first 8 bytes, and that equals the value in the 9th byte. And if they agree, it decides that that's good. But I don't know for sure how this protocol works. The second line is where I actually get the temperature reading. Now, it's the same line of bytes of information. So the two of them, both those pieces of information are all combined in the reading from the sensor. And the number here is minus 3,500. The units is in thousands of a degree centigrade. So to make degrees centigrade, I divide this by 1,000, minus 3.5 degrees centigrade. And that, if you convert that to Fahrenheit, that's 25.7 degrees Fahrenheit. A week or two ago, I mean, this is a real value I read out of my temperature sensor. It's in an unheated garage, and that's, you know, winter temperature. That's what the temperature was. So that's an example of how you can do I/O on a Raspberry Pi.
So if you have these sensors in the house, you have to wire them all the way, right?
Yes. If you're going to go wireless, these are wired sensors, but if you're going to go wireless, you have to have a power source in order to do wireless communication. If you're going to talk to it. So like this, okay, this sensor is connected, it's very close to the Raspberry Pi, it's on a 6-foot wire, because the Raspberry Pi also has a webcam on it, and they're in this unheated garage looking out the window. Now I need, and I don't have a network, it's remote from my network. It also has a Wi-Fi dongle plugged into it. And it's got a power supply. It plugs into the wall. I mean, I'm using line power for this particular one. And it's just sitting in my garage, running these two devices for me, letting me remotely look at what my webcam sees and remotely know the temperature.
By the way, you know, what happens is if you feed all 9 of those bytes through the CRC circuit, that's how you know it's correct.
Ah, okay. Did you do the math? And
he did the math.
Bob?
As a matter of fact, it probably does.
On the one-wire bus? I think probably a couple hundred feet. I don't know for sure. But I have information about the one-wire. I have information about the one-wire protocol. If you go to my URL, There's actually a link you can click on about one wire, and I did find a spec for it there. And so I've got the spec for this particular sensor and the spec for the bus, if you know, to tell you precisely how long it can be.
And by the way, the sensors that I'm using use a different one wire protocol.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
And what some of the stuff that's on my board is to level shift it up to 5 volts so that you can haul even further, because the one wire plus carries further at 5 volts than it does at 3 volts.
Yep, I can believe that. Okay, so I'm not going to dive in deep anymore to these devices. It's really more than we had time for. So I'm going to move on, talk about radio, right? We're all interested in radio. And in radio applications, or other applications, why would you even use a Raspberry Pi or an Arduino? They're readily available. They're cheap. They're good for prototyping. They're development boards. They're intended for educational use, which means there's a ton of information about them freely available. You can get parts. You can get tutorials. You can get example programs. All this stuff is easy to come by. You know, it's technology is not very old, so it's a little old, but not very old, so it's cheap and plentiful. And there's a lot of critical mass. You know, these happen to be the ones that got popular. It could have been the BeagleBone instead of the Raspberry Pi. It's about an equally powerful board. TI promised they would support the BeagleBone for 10 years after they introduced it, but Raspberry Pi caught on. I mean, that's my reasons for picking these boards to work with, is it's just easy. Remember, these are development boards, and when you go to deployment, you want to use something like what James has instead of a big development board. It takes up a lot more space. Now let's compare them. How do you know which to use? I haven't shown you the graph, but I'll show you the graph again with Raspberry Pi and Arduino on them. On Arduino, it's just your program running there. There's nothing else. You've got complete control of it if you needed precisely to control timing. I wanted to decode the pulses coming from an infrared remote control. So I put an infrared photodiode on an Arduino, and I shined a light at it, and it could read when it was high and low and the amount of time in between, and it was capable of doing that. On a Raspberry Pi, you'd be hard-pressed to do that because you've got an operating system. There's interrupts all the time. It's keeping track of the time. It's talking to USB. Maybe it's talking to the network. And all this other stuff is going on. It gives you a lot more power because there's stuff there ready for you to call on, but you're in a multi-programming environment where you don't have such precise control over the hardware. So if timing's important, the Arduino may be a better bet. Raspberry Pi CPU, 200 times faster than the Arduino, and a ton more memory, 30,000 times as much memory. Raspberry Pi needs a lot more power to run. They can be battery powered, but you're looking at a couple of watts for Raspberry Pi. An Arduino, you know, you can run 1/10 of a watt, less than that even. And it's all going to boil down to, and I can't give you the answer, you know, this particular application, this device. How much power you need, how much compute power you need, how fast does a computer have to be, how much data do you have to handle? We already saw examples of how you can extend the ability to store data. The island keyer that we passed around that had that extra chip that could store, you know, thousands of characters of data. Or in the Raspberry Pi, there's always an SD card. You have to have that to boot it. So that's got additional memory capacity. What type of devices you needed to talk to. Yes, you can make an Arduino talk USB, but you're going to use much of the capability of Arduino just to talk USB, whereas that's one of the things that's built right into Raspberry Pi. So that's going to be a consideration as well. So back to my summary of everything. This is the seven fastest computers we talked about, starting all the way on the left with the original IBM PC. Next faster computer, PDP-8, was faster than that, but a lot less memory. 6600, supercomputer from the 60s, then an Arduino. It's more powerful than a 6600. More powerful than a supercomputer from my lifetime, when I handled and fed cards into and worked the operator's console. It's amazing, that little cheap chip there. A white box, the Raspberry Pi, and finally, you know, the black box, which is a lot. But look at where the Raspberry Pi is. The Raspberry Pi is like a personal computer that you would have bought 7 years ago. That's a lot of computer on a tiny little board for $35. So, I mean, that's really why we're replacing computers with it. That is, you know, that's a very impressive device. The Arduino is really targeted at something different. Precise control, running your washing machine and so on, perfect device for that. I'm going to talk about one peripheral that I think is great for radio. This is the SI5351 from Silicon Labs, CMOS clock generator. This device is intended originally to replace crystal oscillators. You know, we use crystal oscillators in our radios. They used to be, you know, you were rock bound, stuck on certain channels, whether you're doing CW or you're doing 2 meters or citizens band. You had crystals for particular frequencies, and you could operate on those frequencies. Well, this has a crystal inside, one crystal, usually to drive this, like a 25 or 27 megahertz crystal, and then it uses dividers and a VCO in a phase lock loop by changing the amount of division to pick arbitrary frequencies of output. With part per million differences in the frequencies you can choose, because it's about a 20-bit number, which gives you enough bits to count up to a million, that's used to set the frequency. Granted, it's a little more complicated than that. It's controlled by I squared C, how you tell the device, you know, what divider to use, things like that, which means either an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi can easily tell this device what it needs to do. The outputs are 3 volts peak to peak. Depending upon which one you use, there's either 3 or 8 independent outputs, and each one can give you a different frequency. They share some of the dividers, so you don't have complete control of them all. What you get out of this is a square wave, okay? So a square wave means that there's going to be harmonic content, the fundamental at amplitude 1, and then the odd harmonics, the third harmonic at 1/3 the amplitude of the fundamental, the fifth harmonic at 1/5 the amplitude, and so on, is what the frequency spectrum looks like coming out of this device. Well, we all have, you know, bandpass filters at the ends of our transmitters to make sure that we do not have harmonics transmitting out of band. If you're on 20 meters, you're also going to have a 10-meter signal in the second harmonic, for example. If you're on 2 meters, you might have a third harmonic on 70 centimeters. And if you're doing SDR, you really want a digital signal that's on and off at the right rate to do the signal processing. You don't want an analog signal that doesn't give you that sharp transition. So Adafruit, which is my favorite supplier for a couple of reasons.
You just like Lady Ada. Yeah.
No. Yeah. I actually don't find her necessarily that attractive, but she's smart. So here we've got an Adafruit SI5351 breakout. This chip is the SI5351 surface mount chip. We've got voltage regulators. We've got translators. This can work with either 3.3-volt logic or 5-volt logic. To give you an idea of the size, these pins are 1/10 of an inch apart. When you buy the kit, you get this board and you get the pins. You can either solder right to it, or you can put the pins in and then you can poke it into a breadboard. So what we've got is we've got power in, ground, we've got the I squared C, the data, and the clock for that, and then we've got the 3 outputs, 0, 1, and 2. And we also have pads up here where you can solder an SMA connector for each of these 3 outputs, clock 0, clock 1, and clock 2. So you want coax to pick them up, it's pretty easy to do. An example of using the SI5351, and that board, by the way, was, I think it's $7 when I bought one at Adafruit a year or so ago. In January of this, a year ago, QRP Quarterly had an article called "Let's Build Something," a single sideband, one band transceiver. So sideband, transmit and receive by these two guys. And they're using an Arduino to control the SI5351, which is a variable frequency oscillator controlling what frequency you're tuned to, and a beat frequency oscillator, which is the signal you insert to the sideband when you're detecting it, or that you use to mix with audio when you're encoding it, modulating it back, you know, on the transmit side. A couple of URLs that point to it. There's a part 2 article. They've got a website with a URL here. Here's a block diagram of that. I'm not going to go through this in detail, but here's the front end, the antenna end, and your RF circuitry, and here is the mixer doubly balanced mixer with the VFO feeding into it. And then you've got your IF amp on crystal filter giving your selectivity. Down here, product detected from the IF frequency to mix down to audio. And the BFO that's coming in the other signal, and the audio is going to come out here or just reverse the path for transmit. And here's the other place where it's using SI5351. It's got three outputs. You only need one of them to drive it at both these points. So, you know, you could build that on a board that's not that big, and you built it yourself. It's a totally different thing than something you bought. So some pointers, NT7S is using SI5351 to build an HF rig. PA0WRE, another website that has them. M0XPD, another project using it, AK2B. And W6JL is this ham on the West Coast, totally home-built station with, for example, an amplifier that has more gain than you can legally buy an amplifier for his HF station, and just completely home built. And I believe he's also using SI5351 in there. More things people use Arduinos for: rotor controller, N6QW, who was the motivation behind the Let's Build Something we just talked about. He's got some other projects with Arduinos. Larry told me that KF4ZZ is working on a controller for step IR antenna. I didn't have a URL for that, but I don't know if you have any more information about that. And now let's look at some radio uses for Raspberry Pi. Voice over internet protocol, IRLP, supports Raspberry Pi right now. As Bob told you earlier in this meeting, the MMRA is deploying Raspberry Pis for IRLP. Echo Link can be done on Raspberry Pi. Asterisk, another voice over IP application, can be done on Raspberry Pi. Raspbian software packages, there's a ton of ham radio packages. Oops, More Raspberry Pi packages. So there's a lot of Raspbian packages for ham radio. And here's a pointer to them. Another guy, G0HWC, is doing a bunch of projects in his shack with Raspberry Pi. Something I think the MMRA should look into: the Open Repeater Project is developing a low-cost, feature-rich repeater controller using single-board computers like Raspberry Pi and BeagleBone Black. Is it reality yet, or is it vaporware still? I don't know, but you know, maybe that's our future replacement for the 7K controllers. M0XPD has got a 40-meter beacon controlled by Raspberry Pi. Someone else has got a packet bulletin board system controlled by Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi itself will emit on various frequencies RF without external circuitry. So this guy has a project on GitHub, which is a place where people share code to make a Raspberry Pi into a transmitter. And if you Google for Raspberry Pi ham radio or Arduino ham radio, you know, you will get pages of things you can go look at. I entered this command on Raspbian, apt-cache search ham, and only matched the lines of output that have the word radio in them. So that says, search for packages related to ham, and now it could be ham and eggs also, and then weed out any ones that don't, in what it gave me back, weed out any ones that don't have the word radio in them. And this is what popped up. And there's at least this many things: FL Digi for digital mode, AX25, ham exam, there's probably a CW tutor in here, yeah, Morse, and so on. So there's, you know, a logging application. And that was without trying very hard. You know, if you look more, there'd be more. So, please do.
So at Foxborough, I did a talk about Chirp, and you can run Chirp on your Raspberry Pi. And if you have these old monitors, like many of us do, you can actually mount the Raspberry Pi right to the back of your monitor, and you've turned your monitor into a computer in your ham shack to program your radios.
Well, in fact, that Raspberry Pi I passed around is on a VESA mount, which is intended to be screwed right into the back of a monitor. So you can also use it as, you know, a set-top box to drive a screen for entertainment in your living room, which is why I bought that Visa mount.
You also use the Raspberry Pi without anything. Go headless, which is how I run mine. I don't have a monitor. You know, once I put the images in,
yep.
How do you need it? So, and I use it to access the internet to get more reflective for these guys.
Mm. Nice.
It's beautiful. Greatest thing in the world.
Question on as far as using a wall wart near the radio. I know I discovered when I first got my VHF rig that the noise floor was, I was having signal, you know, meters, and then I unplugged this one little wall wart on the other side of my room and it dropped. Is there any like recommended power supplies for these things?
Well, the problem, yeah, so this problem of getting noise from wall warts, the problem is they're switching power supplies. And so you've got a sudden transition of a signal, which means that there's going to be all kinds of higher frequencies. It's not just a transition from one DC level to another. So this little device, okay, it's got a lithium battery in it, 3.6 volts, and it's got a step-up switching power supply. So when I plug in and there's a load, I'm sure, although I haven't used it with a radio, I'm sure it emits RF as well. So these guys, your best bet is, you can't do this on both sides, if you could wrap them around a bar of ferrite, you know, a bar of ferrite to contain the signal, not to let it go past that point, then your wire won't act as an antenna. That may give you a little relief. And it's a lot better, that core that clips on it, it's just not enough turns. It's more effective if you get a bar of ferrite and wrap it around. Pardon? Yes. If
you could get a little TO92, you know, LM78LO5 and just wire it in and you're done.
I know they recommend a 2 amp. When you get one of these, they recommend a 2 amp. I don't know.
Well, that's for driving all of your USB peripherals. And really, the Raspberry Pi itself doesn't need a lot of power, but if you've got four USB peripherals you're powering out of the Raspberry Pi, it's 2 amps right there.
Yeah, a max of.
But that's what I would do.
So I'm going to leave you with my last slide. There's a bunch more if you care about more references, where to get the parts. And as I said, my reason for Adafruit, they're in New York City. Standard shipping, it gets here in a day or two. It's out of state. You're not paying sales tax. And there's a ton of tutorials on their website. You know, you want to figure out more about how to do something, I would highly recommend you look at them. Thank you. You can tell I love old computers.
That's a living room.